series, we get Redskins, some of the concern sponsors, of course. And Ms. Denson, did anybody want to say anything or make a presentation before we begin?
President Suzette Denslow from the mayor's office. I believe that we've made a lot of presentations, and I know you've heard from us before. What we would like to do is to, if you would like, Chris Hilbert had intended to be here to talk about the package of enhancements that we discussed over the last few days. And he is at the doctor's with his wife, who's been in the hospital recently. So we've asked Mr. Samuels if he would represent Chris in talking about that, if that suits City Council.
That's perfect. What I thought I would do is the way that we're going to do this evening. And the first paper that we'll discuss is number 29, which is the city accepting the deed from the school board to convey 5800 Patterson Avenue to the city and to authorize the CAO to act on behalf of the city and execute the deed. That's number 29. Are there questions or discussion on number 29?
Yes.
Okay, Joel.
The backroom negotiating that took place over the weekend was done by Mr. Thompson.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but what this paper says is that the schools will convey the property to the city, period. That's it. This is just the deed conveyance.
Wait a minute, what is that? I thought we were going to go through
I'm on paper number 29. This one's going to be any questions about paper 29.
Oh.
Which is the deed conveyance.
Which is...
of the community's choice. And that relocation upgrade is going to be
estimated a deposit of $33,000 upon execution of this agreement between the Economic Development Authority and Bonds and Courts for the lease of the West Hampton property. Now, this can be in the form of a letter of credit, and this amount would be credited to the first annual $33,000 payment that we spoke about a few minutes ago. That's the sum of the agreement for the West Hampton property. Madam President, would you care for me to stop there, allow any questions to be asked, or would you want me to go through the entire deal? It seems like a lot of having to listen to the talk.
I think let's do A and B.
Okay,
West Hampton, are there questions on these enhancements to this package or comments or Mr. Chowder?
Thank you, Madam President. I think it's fair to say that Mr. Hilbert, Mr. Jewell and myself spent a large amount of time over the past weekend working on these things, trying to come up with resolution. In fact, we were working on all these things up until I walked into chambers prior to Mr. Hilbert having to jump into his appointment. With that being said, I want to look at this. I've got a couple of questions. First of all, item number 9 deals with the lease term, land lease term of 60 years. So in the original document, my understanding was 60-40. So are we stopping the arrangement at 60 years, or is it continuing in another 40 on the West End of the property?
Of $1,742,000. two.
Where's the million $742?
That is the assessed value of the land, the 4 acres prorated.
Okay. All right, that's helpful. Thank you. The other aspect to use would be, the would endeavor to maintain the historic nature of the property. What are we trying to do here? I've had several conversations with folks from various organizations and community organizations that basically feel very strongly about preservation of the schools. And I want to make sure what we're saying in this line, what do we mean?
Well, I think it's appropriate that Bond Secours would address their intentions as it relates to the historic nature of the property.
Jim Dunn with Bond Secours, we have indicated that we want to do everything we can to utilize as much of the buildings as possible until we can bring back the projected use and then get architects and engineers in the building to look at what would be required for the projected use. We don't know exactly what that looks like, but we have reached out to the Historic Richmond Foundation to ask them to serve as our advisor as we go through that process. And we understand that in the additional enhancements that you have, that we are specifically interested in the right angle facades on Patterson and Libby Avenue. So that's our commitment, to do everything we can to utilize as much of those facilities as possible with the help of the Historic Richmond Foundation to provide us.
So to make sure I understand, what you're saying is your first choice is to maintain the facades on Libby and Patterson Avenue. If it's possible to maintain any other aspects of the structure, you will look into that.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
That's correct. And the special use permit will dictate this conversation.
Yes.
And we understand that over there.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, I've had conversations with folks, and I don't know how Historic Richmond can step in and act as an agent in this discussion. I don't know if they've done this before or not. I'm just not familiar with any arrangement like this at all.
I would have to defer to them in terms of whether they've done this before, but again, we reached out to them a couple of weeks ago to see if they would be willing to assist us.
Did y'all get an answer?
Yes, we did.
Okay. And the answer was yes?
Yes.
Okay. That's helpful. Thank you.
Madam President.
Mr. Jewell.
Before Mr. Dunn sits down, I talked with the director, with the director of Historic Foundation this morning. You have indicated that you've been in partnership with them, and she says not once has she met with you guys. Now, I'm glad to see this plan come.
I believe that the director is here. If she could help answer that, we called her. Our vice president of construction called her approximately 2 weeks ago, made the request, and asked if they would be willing to work with us in an advisory capacity. A member of the staff actually went in the building with our vice president of construction week before last to take a look, and we also they were in attendance at St. Mary's Hospital at the community meeting we held last Tuesday evening. So we don't have a written agreement of any kind, but we have certainly been in contact and communication, and that was our request of the foundation. But I would defer to the director for any clarification.
Well, that would be helpful, because my understanding that while they were at that meeting, they were screaming internally because representations were made that they felt otherwise. So perhaps that person can come forward so that we would know. Look, this whole thing has been a whirlwind. We've only known about this 2 weeks. The information that we've got has been sporadic best. And so whatever we get, whatever we do before this vote tonight, it is seriously in need of being accurate and with no space in between us. So that's the reason I'm doing it. Please.
We look forward to
working with... Sorry, first time's thrown down. Sorry, you have to identify yourself.
Mary Jane Hood, the Executive Director of the Historic Richmond Foundation. And we love the Redskins. We love Bon Secours. I could not live in my house if I wasn't a Redskin lover. All my children were born there. My grandchildren were born there. We were invited to go into the building. Charles Peters and Amy Swartz, my chief preservationist, went in. There was no conversation, according to Charles Peters and Amy Swartz, about next steps. Our name has been used, that we are in partnership on the radio, that we're on a committee. We have not had any of those invitations. I did talk to Richard Banta Tuesday night after the community meeting and said that we really would like our name not to be used until we had a sit down, face to face, real conversation, which we have not had. And I understand people are really busy, but I really would love a true commitment from Bon Secours that that will happen and that we're not just talking about saving a right angle of a building on Patterson and Libby. That's not the right answer for the first discussion. So, but we look forward to having that conversation if indeed Bon Secours would like us to be a part of that. And yes, we do have architects and engineers and a list of resources and people on our board that have that expertise.
If I could respond to that, and I know Mr. Band is on vacation, not here, but his intent was certainly that we were going to bring you folks in, and again, with the exception of that one visit, that's the only opportunity we've had to even get into the building. So that is our commitment. We are asking Historic Richmond Foundation to work with us in an advisory capacity when we get to the point that we have a proposed use and that we can have the architects and engineers and others that would work with us through that process. And there are a lot of things being said in the media by a lot of people that aren't true and are misrepresented, and we have experienced that firsthand as late as about 2 hours ago. So you're hearing it from me. You'll hear it from our CEO this evening, but that's absolutely our intent.
Thank you, Stan. Maybe you two want to exchange cards.
I agree. Conversation's a great thing.
Madam President, that's what I was trying to achieve. We got no time for any daylight in between any of us on this deal. It's just been that fast. The $32,000 for 10 years for non-real estate taxes. Can someone tell me what that is and how that's derived?
Mr. Joel, I apologize. Suzanne Hensler from the Mayor's Office. Could you repeat the question, please?
Item five, $32,000 for 10 years from other new non-real estate taxes. What non-real estate taxes and how is that derived?
Mr. Joel, we were looking for, we looked at the sheet of estimated tax revenues that would be derived from the West Hampton School property. And in addition to real estate taxes, there were also business personal property taxes and B-poll taxes. We can't specifically estimate the B-poll taxes because a lot of that information is confidential, but also because until the doctors are hired and the personnel in the building, we don't actually know what the receipts and the revenues coming through are. So the estimate we used was a kind of a round number. We used about $32,000 was our good faith estimate.
Now, medical facilities are totally different from office facilities. There's infrastructure that gets built on the floors and over top of ceilings that never see the light of day. got all sorts of stuff going on in the medical building. It means that for construction of an office building, you're talking $100 a square foot. I don't know. I'm no builder. But for medical facilities, it could be $300 to $400 a square foot. Now, if you're telling us that they don't even know, if I heard right, Mr. Dunn, they don't even know yet what type of medical facility they're going to build out there, how in God's name can we possibly know the tax? Particularly the personal property tax, we can forget real estate tax easily, but there would be slim to none there. But we are talking about the personal property tax, commercial personal property tax. When you've got x-ray machines, you've got God only knows what goes into those facilities. If it's a medical clinic, and it does say office / clinical space, how do we arrive at what that figure might be at $32,000 if we got no clue what's going to be in the building, how it's going to be used?
Mr. Joel, it's a good question. As you said, we can estimate about the size of the building, and we know about what's projected to be spent on it. So that's about $24 million, which is how we came up with the $288,000 a year for real estate taxes. And the best we can do with business license taxes, with B-poll taxes, and business personal properties, we make a guess. And these are, they're not huge numbers. It's a conservative number, hopefully. But it's a number that we felt we can, rather than say we will take the new B-poll taxes, we will take the new business personal property taxes and dedicate them, we thought it was safer to just say, let's put a number in there and live with it and assume that we will see $32,000.
At least that's how they open the open. I've got to say that there's been a lot of movement from this time last week. Yes. This thing was ugly last week, and it appeared that it was purposeful that we were trying to counterfeit what by ordinance would have gone to the school's capital budget. It's a long way from where we were. On at the bid all week. I did not get this until I got here today. I don't quite know how I've heard about the taxes rolling off of West Hampton property. I've heard about the taxes rolling off Lee Street property. Have we dedicated anything for, or is that included in any way of what the 8-point some million dollar expansion that's supposed to happen in East Hampton? Is that in the deal out of the deal?
Mr. Joel, we, after having a discussion with, as you know, there was a lot of outreach to different people, and different people reached out to us. And after some of those discussions, our thought process was the West Hampton school property was the focus of the people who were concerned about the school money not returning to schools. Because the Bon Secours commitment was to develop the Redskins site on Lee Street, we decided those were the two focal points for the money that should be going to schools. We did not dedicate money from the East End, even though there was some discussion about that. I think we felt, let's stick primarily to West Hampton, let's talk about some of the increased taxes from Lee Street, and let's see if we can get to a number, and I'll digress a little bit. But the number that Mr. Hilbert was trying to reach was a number that over 10 years would equate to what we likely would have sold West Hampton School for. So for the school proponents, and I think everyone here is a school proponent, for the school proponents, it gave a comfort level that over the 10 years we generate this money, and the present day value of that would be in the 4 point something million dollar range, probably low 4.1, 4.2 million dollar range, so that they would be receiving the money that they would have gotten if the school had been sold. And that was the big concern that Mr. Gilbert expressed, and I think expressed after having conversations with several of you.
Well, I'm not going to be hard about it. amount is shown up, to begin putting money in place, saving money for what is now four schools being constructed. And that's a good thing, and we all ought to celebrate that. But my understanding is that there's nothing in school construction going forward anywhere in the near or far future. We clearly aren't halfway to the construction needs that we got. And so I'm not trying to bleed everything out of this project to handle that. That's not my issue. It's just that I need to put it on somebody's horizon that we can't stop building schools now. And so part of what my resistance was to be able to make that point. We can't keep cheating children and expect them to perform highly.
And Madam President, Mr. Jewell, again, it's something that every single person on this council has raised as a concern. And I know one of the things that we've talked about in the last year in working with the school system is to set up a process where we work with the school board, members of city council, and the community, and we talk about what's important in this community in terms of new capital outlay we need to make for schools, what's important for the enhancements schools need, and then let's figure out a way to fund it. And that's, I think, what we do need to do next. And we have tried, and as you say, people have tried before us, we've tried, I know, with this administration, with this city council, to put money up for four new schools, and you know all the statistics that I know. First high school in 40 years, new middle school, two new elementary schools, and there's still more to be done because we have a lot of old buildings and we have a lot of buildings that are falling down. And we do need to move forward, but the main way that's going to happen is through the real estate taxes. It's through your normal budget process every year when we do dedicate those monies to schools. And we want to work with you on doing that.
And more.
And in addition to when there is a surplus property, but the sustainable model is through our real estate.
And on adjusting our priorities.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much.
Councilmember, I just want to add one other thing to what Suzette just said. I think she covered adequately, except for one thing that we should tease out. In the next 2 months, this body will have to forward school CIP along with the city's CIP. Schools comes in January to us, and the school board will actually vote on that. And in March, we'll bring you the RCIP, including theirs. There'll be the opportunity at that point to talk about what schools' needs are with respect to capital maintenance or new capital construction. It's my understanding that schools just recently completed a study of all of their boilers and HVAC, and they show where the deficits are later. They've just also completed a study of their athletic fields and facilities, and they've pointed out what the needs are there. And then, you're probably aware, in 2009, they not only put forward a plan for new construction and the order in which the schools should be built, but they also put forward a plan for major renovations to schools. So you'll have all of those pieces of information in front of you, and a set of priorities can be teased out from those compared to what's in the city's overall plan of fiscal year 14 through fiscal year 18.
Thank you, Mr. Jewell.
Other questions about these? This resolution is going to come forward tonight. It's going to come forward for us to be expedited. We need to pass it. So are there other questions about this? Mr. Tyler, did you have a...
Yes, okay.
I just wanted to give everybody...
I want to make sure, if anybody's got other questions.
Right.
Mr. Marshall. I just want to ask a question on item number two, package deal. I want to make sure that we're all on the same page. On the West End, item number two, city and council and mayor agree to maintain the levels of capital improvement program for schools at the level of 2012. My understanding of this is that, and I'll use an arbitrary number, we have $100 million set aside right now before this
CMP budgets have been adopted between 2009 and 2013, which equal $150.9 million for schools, and the approved CIP between 14 and 17 is another $50.4 million. We will not supplant that money. So schools will get $201 million in addition to this month.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that we're going in the same direction. That's what I needed to hear. Okay. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you, Mr. Trammell. Other comments or questions on this enhancements to the economic development?
Yes. Thank you, Madam President. I had the opportunity to be briefed a little earlier today on these changes, and I would just like to thank staff and council colleagues who work to really provide us with an even better package, certainly in terms of the concerns relative to schools. And so I'd like to also thank all supporters as well as the Redskins partners here, but again, to really just say thank you to staff and my colleagues who work on this.
Thanks, Madam. You want to go? Without saying, I concur with you 100% and thank those council members, Hans Core and Redskins, for enhancements in this economic development package, and also to staff who I know spent a lot of turkey day working on this. Are there other questions on this? Okay, all right, then the next paper we're going to go to.
But
you will get one.